I want y'all to know, Happy Father's Day. Amen.
Yes.
And, you know, as whenever we talk about fathers, you know, there's a lot of different aspects that we can talk about regarding being a father and regarding, you know, our children and things of that nature. But at the same time, God always kind of like sends me in a certain direction. And it's usually always a pretty spiritual type concept that you have to be able to trust in the Lord to be able to see what's really spiritually taking place rather than just looking at all the practical things that can happen. But one of the ideas behind fatherhood, I believe, in order for us to be, now whenever we're talking about being fathers, we're not just talking about being good fathers, we're talking about being godly fathers. We're talking about being fathers that can impart godly wisdom into our children. Amen. And in order for us to be able to do that, we have to be able to touch the Lord. And what I'm talking about is we have to be able to hear His counsel. We have to be able to receive instruction of Him. We have to be taught of Him, discipled by Him, learners of Him. Other than that, then what we do is we're just filled with a bunch of worldly wisdom.
Amen.
And then that's what we end up imparting to our children. If you turn with me to the book of Proverbs, chapter 22, famous verse. I probably preached this last year for Father's Day. At least this particular verse was in there. And who knows, maybe I'll preach it again next year. I might have even preached it, might have even thrown it in there for my Mother's Day message. I don't know. But I really like this passage of Scripture. It's the one, it's famous Scripture. Everybody's familiar with it, where it says, train up a child in the way he should go. You remember that Scripture. Now, there was a preacher that I used to know real well, and I really respected the guy, but I always felt like he was preaching this passage wrong, and I'm not trying to pick on him, but one of the things that the Scripture, basically, this is what it says. It says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. And so what that preacher would say is that when it regarded the way, what the idea was that the father should know the way that his children are supposed to go. And what he was talking about is your child may have a proclivity or a desire to go towards things like science. So therefore, you should push them down the pharmacy or the doctor road. Or your child may have a proclivity towards being able to work well with his hands. So you should push him towards being a mechanic or whatever the case. I got to tell you that that's not the meaning of that passage of Scripture.
Amen.
This book is a book written by God for the people of God. And it's instruction to God and how a man or a woman or a child should walk with God.
Amen.
And so when it talks about the way, it's talking about the way, the pathway of the Christian journey. Yes, back then it was written in the Old Testament, but it was talking about the way for the children of Israel, who were the people of God, to walk the pathway of God. Amen. I couldn't help but think about the different things that fathers are typically known for. I mean, as far as for the skill level that they have, I don't know what your daddy was good at, but you know, some dads, man, look, when it comes to fishing and hunting and fixing and building, man. And look, they got some guys that they spend so much time understanding those things, right? I mean, a person that really loves to fish, I just wasn't ever much of a fisherman. Hey, I like to eat them. I wish I could catch them better, but I can't. But people that like to fish, dude, they know about bait. You know what I'm saying? I mean, they got their bait, and dude, they're serious about it. And a lot of times, I wouldn't even be surprised they don't research it. People that hunt, I've talked to people that know how to hunt before. And I mean, look, some people get into it really big. He said, man, look, I climb a tree. I make my own stand. They know about wind direction. They know about scents. People that know how to crawfish, they know exactly where to lay the trap according to the current. So that all these kinds of things. And they have to learn these things through a process of time. People that know how to build things and fix things. I used to watch my dad. I can remember watching my dad when I was growing up. It seemed like my dad could fix anything. Man, I'm telling you, it'd just be a day he'd wake up and he just start tearing stuff apart, parts all over the place, and then just build it back together. And it's like, why'd you do that? Just felt like knowing how the thing worked. And you know, but I can remember walking in the garage one time when I was just a little kid, probably in a kindergarten, you know, looking for dad, you know, and there he is. Boy, he's just tearing something apart. And I'm like, hey dad, what you doing? And with a snarl, I hate to say it, but daddy was kind of rough. He said, get out of here, boy. He didn't want me to have nothing to do with what he was doing. He didn't want to teach me nothing about fixing stuff. And sometimes I wish my daddy would have taught me how to fix stuff, because I hate fixing stuff now. And you know what? I'll be honest with you. If I knew how to fix my own stuff, I'd probably save a whole lot of money. But it's almost like I'm still rebelling against him and saying, good, you don't want to teach me how to fix stuff, then I'm not going to fix it and I'm going to pay for it. It's like I'm over here hurting myself, right?
Yeah.
What I want you to know is this, is that all that's good. There's nothing wrong with teaching kids how to fix stuff, right? There's nothing wrong with teaching kids how to fish. One day they might be able to have to feed their own selves and their family. Nothing wrong with teaching a kid how to hunt. But what I need you to know is that if you're going to train up a child in the way that they should go, you're going to have to apply yourself as a father in order to learn the ways of God, in order for you to ever be able to train up a child in the way that they should go. Truth be told, the word train there literally means to dedicate or to narrow. So it's talking about dedicating something unto God and narrowing the way. See, Matthew chapter 7 verses 13 and 14 says that wide is the gate, broad is the way that leads unto destruction.
Amen.
But straight is the gate and narrow is the way that leads unto eternal life, and few there be that find it. And the truth be told is that this whole big old world is headed in a certain direction, and they're heading there fast. And as the people of God, we have to make sure that we apply ourselves, like even Sabrina said this morning, touch God, receive the counsel of God, learn of God, so that we might impart the things of God into our children. If you're leaving, listen to me, this church operates a lot different than most churches in the modern day. We are desiring so much to try to teach your children the Word of God. Not coming up with some groovy little program or some cool little thing that the kids are going to like. That, we're not about that. We're not about that in the big church. We're not about that in children's church. I guarantee you the teachers that we have, they're trying their best to teach the Bible to your children. And one of the things that I need you to understand is that's a big part of what a father is supposed to do. He's supposed to be able to train up his children in the ways that he should go, talking about the ways of God, so that when he grows old, he won't depart from me.
Right.
I can remember a time whenever I used to think that I was going to try to, before the Lord really got a hold of me, that I was going to try to push my kids maybe towards becoming a doctor. Almost like I realize now I could have done it. I wish I would have done it because it just would have changed some things. Not that I don't like my job or whatever the case, because I do. I'm very appreciative for my job. But I just wish I would. And I can remember like talking to them as when they were young. You know, and I was almost like, without realizing it, trying to push him in that direction. When the Lord transformed my life, all that went.
Yeah.
And what the Lord began to show me is you need to push him down my path.
You need
to push him towards what I've called them to do.
Yeah.
You can try to push them all day long, try to get them to make the best grades today. And listen, I've instilled that in my kids. You need to apply yourself towards excellency in everything that you do, because if you are going to be a Christian that professes Jesus out of your mouth, everything that you do is a reflection on the Lord that you love and you live for. But I'm here to tell you right now that there's a false sense of what success is in the world out there. Listen to me, I was thinking this morning when I woke up about this message, and I thought about whenever I worked part-time at Tesh over there at the ER as a nurse practitioner. I met one of these doctors, it's not important what his name is, he was the cool dude doctor, you know, and everybody liked him, and I got to witness to him a good bit, but I can remember one of the first things that, you know, that he told me that I never forgot. I was like, "What's up, dude, how you doing today?" Living the dream, man. Living the dream. That's what he told me.
Yeah.
And you know, and so it's like every time I would see him, what's happening, man? Living the dream, baby. Living the dream.
Oh,
I'm like, okay. And then before you know it, the more I'm hanging out with him, he starts complaining. Man, this stinks. Man, I can't stand the way that these people come in here and do this. And everybody's seeking drugs. And this one, and I was like, hold on a second. Time out, bro. I thought you were living the dream.
Right.
Well, it's just something that I say.
Huh?
I'm like, because you found out that what it turned out to be wasn't really what you thought it was going to be. Because, see, as you continue to search upon this earth, trying to fill yourself up with what you think is going to bring you happiness and fulfillment, the reality of it is that it just leaves you empty and void of true fulfillment, because you're not going to find it in your job, in your relationship. You're not going to find it in your finances, in your material possessions. You're going to only find it in a true relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. So as fathers this morning, that's one of the main things that I want to tell you is that we must train up our children in the way that they should go. We need to teach them the narrow path. You understand that one of the things, you know, I was even talking to Danielle this morning a little bit about raising children and whatnot. I said, I'm just going to be honest with you. I'm just talking to you right now. I said, the only thing that I really feel like I did right compared to what maybe some people don't do right as a parent, because I want you to know I ain't got it all figured out. You can ask my kids and they'll tell you. I can remember there were times that I was trying to talk to Sierra about a particular thing, whatever it was, it's not important, it's between her and I. And she wasn't like really listening to it. It just happened to be a cabbage right there on the counter. I punched the cabbage and cabbages flew everywhere. So I'm far from perfect, bro. We make coleslaw like that because, you know, it's like I'm just wanting this kid to listen to me because I got some wisdom to impart to her and she don't want to listen. So good. Coleslaw is what we got. So I'm far from perfect. Is it okay if I'm just real with you? Amen. But she got the idea that daddy at least cared and wanted her to understand. Now, okay. But one of the things that I do feel like I did right, and it's only because God intervened in my life at a time when they were still young enough to learn. All right. And what God began to really give me a revelation of was the reality of the gospel. The reality of the gospel in that upon this earth that you and I live in, that there is both the world and the people of God. Period. There's a clear Amen. Distinction yes. and a delineation between the two. Amen. They are not the same. Even though the churches are filled with people, they're not filled with the people of God. Amen. There are sheep and there are goats. There Amen. Are wheat and Amen. There are tares. Yes. And the reality Amen. Of it is that what God allowed me to do when he allowed me to see the gospel was to properly explain to my girls that there was a difference between the world and the church. And I mean, I'm telling you, when I trained a minute. We talked about it when we drove to school in the morning. We talked about it when we drove home from school in the afternoon. We talked about it at nighttime, and we talked about it in the morning time. We talked about it when they said, well, daddy, I don't understand. When I ride to church with this one that goes to our church, they listen to country music on the radio. Am I not allowed to go to ride with them? I'm like, no, you can ride with them, and you don't even have to stick your fingers in your ear. You can't control what other people are going to do, but I'm here to tell you that secular music will offend anybody on purpose, but I did come here to tell you the truth this morning. I don't really care whether you like what I'm saying or not. The world's music is preaching another message. It's preaching another gospel. And if you allow yourself, to be infiltrated with the message of the world, it's going to begin to infiltrate you, and it's going to begin to change yes. your mind, and it's going to change your mindset and your view of the world. And if you allow your children to do it, it's going to begin to change them and their mindsets, and it's going to begin to change their worldview. That was just one thing. I didn't even mean to go off on that. There's a difference between the world, and there's a difference between the people of God. And the people of God are instructed in the ways of God. I hope this makes sense to you this morning. You got to apply yourself. I'm telling you, just as a man applies himself to learning about bait and fishing and sits and hunting, a man has to apply himself to the things of God. And if you don't have a desire to apply yourself that way, you better hold off on having more kids till you pray and ask God to reach down and give you a hunger and a thirst for the things of God that you might impart the things of God unto your children. Because there comes a day when they're going to walk out of the house and all the opportunities that you have now are gone. And you listen Amen. To me. God told Ezekiel, I've called you to be a watchman. And I've called you to tell the people. And it goes the same for a father towards his children. He's called us to be a watchman and to tell them. And if they die and we told them not, then their blood is on our hands. I'm here to tell you this morning, it's your job as a father to instruct That's your right. children in the ways of God. Amen. And listen to me, it ain't cool to be punching cabbages all the time. Amen. Because the kids are watching.
Amen.
And they're thinking, you think kids aren't smart, man? Let me tell you something, kids are smart.
Amen.
They're a whole lot smarter than we give them credit for.
That's right.
And they're watching the way that we handle our business.
That's right.
The way we respond to situations.
Yeah.
And when we speak one thing and our actions bring another thing, then they're thinking back there whenever they're not around. Man, I don't know about all this. How does this stuff work? How does this stuff really, I mean, is this even real? I mean, I don't see it really changing things. They get anger, bitterness rises up in the midst of their heart, right? They want to rebel against what their daddy told them. So I want you to know something. You have to apply yourself, amen, towards the things of God so that you might be able to pour the things of God into your children. Now, turn with me real quick to Psalm chapter 16. Because that's kind of what Psalm 16, I believe, is talking about. King David writing this psalm, just Psalm 16, verse 7, just one verse. It says, I will bless the Lord who hath given me counsel. My reins also instruct me in the night seasons. You know, this word counsel right here describes really to have a consultation. It's almost as though what David realized was that I need to have consultation time with God. I need to have some sit down. I need to get to know the Lord of glory. And we know the life of David. We know that he wrote many of the Psalms. We know that according to, really based upon history and based upon his life, that he was a man that played the harp. He was a psalmist who wrote lyrics to melodies. He would spend time in the field worshiping the Lord, getting to know God, and at the same time desiring to instruct his children, amen, in the ways of God. But what he learned through his consultation time with God is this. It says, my reins also instruct me in the night seasons. You know the word reins literally, this is what it means literally. It's talking about liver, kidneys, intestines. It's talking about innards. Figuratively, it's talking about the inside. It's talking about the inner man. And so what he's saying is that in all my consultation sessions with God, and all my learning of God and receiving counsel from him and instruction from him, at some point in time, his word, his wisdom, his knowledge permeated my inner man and became part of my core and who I was.
Amen.
I'm telling you right now, I don't mean to keep going back to this, but it's the only analogy I know that, because I'm just really, I never have been much into nature except for whenever I was a young kid, and I know some of y'all like to hunt and fish. I can remember whenever I lived with my brother-in-law, Pierre Park, that dude knew everything that you needed to know about catching stuff and killing stuff. It was in him. It was in his core. I mean, he'd just walk out in the backyard and come back with like 12 squirrels in 15 minutes, and the next thing you know, they're making squirrel stew. I don't even understand how you do that. Literally, I mean, killing two squirrels with one bullet. And I mean, he just, how does this stuff happen? He applied himself. Now, as far as I know, he still don't know the Jesus that I preach. And if he doesn't ever learn of this Jesus, he's going to split hell wide open. They ain't got no squirrels to shoot in hell, I can assure you. But my point is this, is that to apply yourself to the things of God, just as other people apply themselves to these types of things, and it becomes the inside of who you are, the core of who you are, to where it begins to pour out of you. You see, that's what David said. He said, my reins instruct me, my inside, my inner man now has been permeated with the consultation of God. And in the night seasons, see, night means dark, seasons means time, dark times, adversity, challenges that come across the way. Listen to me, child of God. If you ain't ever faced any adversity, if you never may face a nighttime season yet, don't worry. Hold on. It's coming.
Yes.
And whenever it comes, you need to know that you got the counsel of God, the consultation of God on the inside, so that your insides, amen, can begin to instruct you when you face the adversities of life and they come upon you, amen. And if a man would apply himself to those things, not only would it allow him to go through those things in a God-honoring way, where God would give him the victory that he needs, but also along the way, he will be imparting those things unto his children.
Right.
Amen?
Yes.
Praise
Amen.
God.
Yeah.
Turn with me real quick to Psalm chapter 32. David again. Psalm 32, verses 8 and 9. He says, I will, this is God talking, I will instruct thee and teach thee in the way which thou shalt go. I will guide thee with mine eye. You know, recently we were talking out of Ezekiel and we talked about the four creatures and the fact that they had eyes all around them. And we referenced that to the book of Revelation and how this is descriptive to the omniscience or the all-seeing nature of God. That there's nothing that happens that he doesn't see. There's nothing that he's not aware of. It also would be descriptive when it's talking about, I will guide thee in the way you shall go. I will guide thee with mine eye. It has the idea behind it that God has foreknowledge. He sees in advance. Amen. The truth be told is that you and I, we don't really see see in advance. Don't get me wrong, though, but this is one thing that the Lord showed me many times as I prayed as a father, because I really didn't want to mess my kids up, okay? And I prayed a lot. And I said, Lord, you know, I need wisdom. And one of the things that the Lord showed me was this, is that I'm omniscient, Matt. I have foreknowledge. I know the step. I know the way you're going to go before you ever go that way. You don't have foreknowledge, but you have something that I've given you called wisdom. And part of that process has been through the mistakes that you've made. And so therefore, you understand if your child goes a certain way, that it's going to possibly lead to disaster along the way. It's your job as a father to instruct them in that pathway and to let them know that you've already been there to some extent and this isn't the way that you want to go. Amen. God wants to lead and guide us with his omniscience and his wisdom. He wants to lead and he wants fathers to lead and guide their children. Amen. Just as the Father in heaven leads and guides his children, just as a pastor is supposed to lead the flock towards the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. And just as a father is supposed to lead his children towards the things of God. The Lord says, I will teach thee, I will instruct thee in the proper way that you shall go. I will guide you with mine eye. God knows the beginning from the end. And listen to me, he wants to speak to us. See, one of the things that I wanted to say about this is that I believe it's important as fathers. I don't really know how else to get this point across. This is sometimes the way that the Lord gives me things is a little bit difficult to explain with words. But then again, I think you'll understand if you just give me 1 second. I'm just kind of talk low, so I hope you don't fall asleep on me. You know, whenever we're learning the ways of God, he's saying this, that the preacher's job, this is something that the Lord showed me, the preacher's job is to teach the people how to allow God to be their pastor. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
To teach the people how to have a relationship through Jesus Christ with the Father, that they might be led and guided by the wisdom of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Not for me to tell you, don't get me wrong, if you need to call me up, we'll talk, we'll pray and all that good stuff. But listen to me, the opinions of the man sometimes are wrong.
Yes. Amen.
The opinions of the Father sometimes are wrong. But if you would be able to have a relationship with Jesus, he would never steer you in the wrong direction.
Amen.
Because all he ever wants to do is love you, amen, and to lead you and guide you. The Word of God says in John chapter 10, he says that my sheep hear my voice. I know them and they follow me. And I got to tell you, Father, that might be a high order to place on your back, but that's the way it is, brother, is that it's your job to learn the will of God. See, I'd be a bad preacher if I didn't tell you that. Oh, no, preacher, that's your job. No, it isn't. Don't get me wrong. We're going to do our part. We're going to do the best we can in trying to teach the kids the Word of God. But you know what I tell the parents when they come into the clinic? I tell the parents, I try to learn to shut up sometimes. I still don't shut up enough, but I try to shut up and I try to listen at least to 3 to 5 minutes of what they got to say. I know that doesn't seem like long, but believe me, it's hard. And I listen to them. And sometimes, I'm going to be honest with you, I got to fight it. Because I got thoughts going in my head. That's a lie. She ain't telling the truth. He ain't telling the truth. Okay, but I listen. I stop and I listen. You know why? You know what I've learned? They with that kid 24/7. I got 5-7 minutes in that room. This is valuable information that if I just blow this off and ignore it, the reality of it is that it could turn into a disaster. The reality of it is for your life, is that whenever the children come to church, they're here maybe what? If you come to every service, really 2 hours of teaching a week, and the rest of the time, they're in your hands. And the reality of it is that it depends upon what you're pouring into their lives, on what they're really going to learn about the things of God. And even if you applied yourself and came to 3 services a week, that's 3 hours a week of teaching that I can assure you that I'm, by the grace of God, trying my best to teach the whole counsel of the Word of God and trying to teach the Word of God and the truth. But the reality of it is that you have to apply yourself, amen, and for you to be able to pour the truth of God's Word into them, amen. And listen to me, I hate to say it, but it ain't going to work, the excuse, but I'm just not that interested. Well, you better start praying and asking God to make you interested in the things of God so that you can pour that into your children, amen. But look at this right here. It says right here in verse 9, Be ye not as the horse or as the mule, which have no understanding, whose mouth must be held in with bit and bridle, lest they come near unto you. So God's saying, I want to lead you. I want to guide you. I want to give you wisdom, and I want mine eye to show you the right way. Be not as the horse or the mule. They have no understanding. You got to put a bit and a bridle in their mouth to make them come. Because you know why? They got stiff necks and they want to turn in the opposite direction. And you got to be able to pull them back in the right direction. Don't be like that. That's what God, but the truth be told is that so many of us are. Now listen, I want to kind of give you a little bit of a relief, Dad. Because the fact of the matter is that you can apply yourself as much as you can by the grace of God to learning the scriptures and trying the best that you now know how to impart wisdom to your child. But the reality of it is that it ain't all on you. See, the book of Proverbs is not a book of promises. It's a book of wisdom.
Yes.
What that means is that mankind still has a free will.
Yes.
A horse or a mule have a free will. At least they seem to exhibit it that way. And they're trying to go in their own direction. And God is aware of that. I'm trying to counsel you. Don't be like a horse or a mule, which need a bit or bridle to make them go in the right direction. See, the book of Proverbs is also filled time and again with the responses towards wisdom. It speaks of the fool, and it speaks of the prudent. See, the fool is one who lacks caution. He lacks foresight. He does not take the wisdom of God into consideration, and instead he moves blindly forward in the direction that he desires to go.
Yes.
The prudent know that there's disaster that lurks ahead if they don't listen to instruction, and they begin to submit themselves to the counsel of God. They begin to submit. So ultimately, you can't be in control of the response of your children. But at the same time, you must, by the grace of God, know that you have applied yourself to teaching your children the truth in the right way. Mm-hmm. You know, one thing that I kind of did was I was just curious about something. I Googled some information, like wondering how many kids leave the church after, you know, they get older. And so I wasn't going to spend a whole lot of time on it because I'm not really much of a statistics guy, but I did. I Googled that. And then something popped up about Kirk Cameron. Now, I don't agree with everything Kirk Cameron does, but you know what? He gets out on the street and he tells people about Jesus and he tells them about the cross, you know, to the level that he understands he's an evangelical Christian. And this was his statistics. 80% of Christian kids leave the church after they graduate from school. 80%.
Wow.
That's a lot.
Yes.
80% of kids leave the church after they graduate from school. It gave me a little thing. If you want to hear more about the story, click right here. So I said, well, let me click right here. Well, his buddy, Ray Comfort, had talked to somebody, and this is what he wrote down. He said, I spoke with a youth pastor friend who spent half of his life serving youth full time. And with the firsthand empirical evidence of years of leading, watching, mentoring, equipping, and counseling teenagers, he said that he can confidently say that most of them were not saved, all in capital letters. They didn't read the Bible regularly. Now, I got to be honest with you. We got to be careful. We don't preach a works-based message. It's not just the reading of the scripture that keeps you saved or keeps you right with God. But if you don't read the scripture, if you don't study the scripture, you don't know the things of God, you don't understand the counsel of God. So you're just over here navigating your journey of life based upon what you're receiving from who? Your peers, your friends, the psychiatrist that you went to, the pediatrician on how he told your daddy that he ought to raise you. Whoever it is that gave counsel, that's the counsel that you received. Because you never took the time to read the scriptures and to learn them for yourself.
Amen.
They didn't share their faith. Now, they never told nobody they were Christians because they were ashamed of their faith. They didn't share their faith. Many were sexually active. Many experimented with drugs. They didn't fight for godly fellowship. In other words, I'm okay. I'll just hang out with the world, dude. It ain't that big of a deal. What's the difference? They were not givers. They dated unbelievers. Look at this. Well, I like this right here. And the list of goat-like qualities goes on. They simply hadn't been translated from darkness to light. They didn't drift away from God after high school. They weren't with God during high school. They drifted away from the church. Fact be told is that when we're talking about 80%, so what that means is this, is that a great number of those kids had Christian parents. A certain number of them didn't. Because youth groups are filled in churches across America where the parents don't even go to church.
Right.
and it becomes a social gathering. But many of these children had Christian parents. And what that means is this. It means that, and for those Christian kids who had Christian parents, their parents did not spend the time instructing their kids in the ways of God, making certain that their kids at least understood God, or if they did, they just had kids that were foolish enough to not believe the word of God. And the fact is this, is that once again, we cannot control their responses, but we have to make sure that we're pouring into them the truth of the gospel.
Amen.
I know no other passage of scripture. I know it's often used. It's out of Hebrews chapter 12. When it talks about the rearing of a child, when it talks about the discipline of a child, I know of no better scripture than Hebrews chapter 12 when it discusses this. I know that we use it often. I think that, you know, I actually probably even used it here recently, portions of it. But out of Hebrews chapter 12, verse 5, starting in verse 5, it says, and you have forgotten. Is everybody there? I need to slow down.
Mm-hmm.
All right. And you have forgotten the exhortation which speaks unto you as unto children. My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. You know, there's a lot to be said about this passage of scripture. And first off, I think that, you know, we always got to try to find out what the real context is that's going on whenever I believe the Apostle Paul wrote the book of Hebrews. It was unsigned, but nevertheless, what was the context that this book was written to? And I know I've explained this to some of you before, but the book of Hebrews was written to Christians who were previously of the Jewish faith. They practiced Judaism. In other words, it seems when you read the book of Hebrews that this was before AD 70. In AD 70, the temple was destroyed by General Titus of the Roman army. And so the temple was destroyed. There was no longer an altar. But when you read through the book of Hebrews, you realize that these Christians who used to practice Judaism and had converted to Christianity were being persecuted and being tempted to go back to their former way of life, which was temple worship and the worship of the sacrifices on the altar. So what was going to happen was that when it says that he who willfully sins, there remains no more sin for no more sacrifice for his sin.
That's right.
The idea there is that it's not just talking about willfully sinning in any way, shape, or form. Because if that was the case, then all of us are guilty, and that means that Jesus' sacrifice won't cover our sin.
Right.
Because we're all guilty of willful sin.
Yeah.
You might not be fornicating and looking at internet pornography, but I can assure you that you are willfully doing something that the Lord has already instructed you not to do.
That's
you just
right.
don't think that it's so bad that God's going to hit that.
Yeah.
You think he's just going to wink at it, but the reality of it is that no, to him who knows not to do sin and does it, to him it is sin. To him who knows to do right and doesn't do it, to him it is sin. Amen?
Amen.
And so what I want you to know is this, is that these Christians were being persecuted and they were gravitating backwards, back towards temple sacrifice, and if they put their faith in the animal sacrifice instead of the eternal lamb, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sin, because that means that they're no longer putting their faith in Jesus as the answer for their sin. They're instead putting their faith in the old order, which has now been outdated and fulfilled in Jesus. Does that make sense? Amen. And so there's a moving backwards and a moving away. And so what I need you to know is this, is that when your child leaves home, and there's coming a day when they will leave home, that the danger still is there for them also. They're going to have to make decisions based upon whether or not they're going to really live for God. Am I going to live for God, or is this just a fable that my daddy told me? Am I going to really serve the Lord? They're going to make all kinds of decisions. Who they're going to marry? Am I gonna marry this person who kind of believes in God, or am I gonna wait for a man or a woman who's more concerned about living for God than anything else?
Amen.
I know I probably shouldn't do this, but I'm going to do it. You know, sometimes I worry about my kids, and I know that, you know, at least one of them's in here right now. I won't worry about her because she might tell me not to say it. Sometimes I worry about my kids because I don't really always know what's going on inside of their head. And I hope that what I'm teaching them is the right way. I mean, I know that what I'm teaching them is the right way. I hope that they're listening to the things that I teach. But recently, Sierra shared with me, it's a long story, I'm not going to try to give away who it was, but some older man tried to ask her out on a date at least two different times. And the problem is this. I mean, I've heard of older men being with younger women. The problem is you don't know nothing about the Lord. That's number one. Okay, number two, I mean, it's just like the way that he's handling it was inappropriate. But she was willing to come out and tell it to me, so it kind of gives me a little bit of hope. She probably won't tell me anything anymore, but I'm just trying to explain. Is that she said he asked me to go do something with him again. And everything that was in me wanted to just break out in a sprint and go in the opposite direction. Run! Forrest, run! And the guy's like, she's like, no, can't do that. And he's like, well, why not? He's like, my daddy won't let me go to the movie with most of the boys my age. And so he's probably thinking, well, she's 19, what the heck's going on? Well, sometimes, girl, you got to make your own decisions. She's like, I don't know. He said, well, maybe I guess you are making your own decision. Yeah. And, you know, what I will say is this, is that I hope it has something to do with the fact that she can see that the dude, he may have a whole lot to offer according to the world standards, I guess. If that's even if he's telling the truth. I mean, he could just be nothing but just trying to take advantage, right? But the reality of it is, you don't know nothing about the things of God. And it ain't going to do no good to try to bring somebody to church a couple times thinking that you're going to get them saved. Hold on a second, mama. You need to slow down and you need to just let God do his work in somebody's heart. Let God do his work in your heart. And then if it be the Lord's will, he can bring it all together when his time is right. But the fact of the matter is that people are oftentimes more worried about who they're going to find in a relationship, who they're going to marry, more than they are about whether or not they're going to serve the Lord or whether or not they're going to find somebody that really desires to serve the Lord. Come on, somebody, tell the truth. We're so consumed and concerned about our fleshly needs and the desires of our own heart that we don't take into consideration the desires in God's heart. And I realize that sometimes we still make those mistakes and God still works in the midst of our lives, but don't think that there's not untold sorrow and pain connected to many of those decisions and those choices. Nevertheless, I was just trying to make the point that there's going to come a day. Just as the children of, just as these Jewish Christians were having to make a choice. Who are you going to serve? Are you going to serve Jesus? Are you going to go back to the way that you previously knew? There's also coming a day when your children are going to leave the house and they're going to have to make, and sometimes even before they leave the house, and we'll get into that in a second, you're going to have to start loosening up a little bit. Oh, there's a right time to loosen up and there's a wrong time to loosen up. After you've already poured your instruction into them, even though they may still be in the house at some point in time, you're going to have to trust. Let me explain that for a second. As I was praying, I was asking the Lord, and you may not completely agree with this, and it's okay if you don't, all right? I mean, if you don't, we could talk about it afterwards. I mean, I don't think you're going to convince me otherwise, but this is what I feel like the Lord showed me. Whenever I try to teach about what true grace is, y'all know what true grace is, right? Did anybody spit that definition out for me real quick? And what? A divine influence on the heart and its reflection in the life. Grace. Divine. What does that mean? God. Right? It's not human. Divine influence on the heart and the reflection. What is a reflection? Something you can see, right?
Yes.
In the life. So true grace isn't just forgiveness from God. True grace is a godly influence on the inner man that doesn't change to the point that you begin to see manifested physically and outwardly in the life of the person.
Yes.
So as I was beginning to pray and ask God to give me wisdom on how to raise my children in true grace, what the Lord began to show me was this. At some point in time, you're going to have to allow the faith to be tested. In other words, as long as they live in your house, you have every right to demand of them that they do this, 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 and this, and if they don't like it, they can pack their bags and they can go if that's the way you choose to do it. But what the Lord also began to show me was that can also be nothing but a bunch of law. A bunch of law, a bunch of rules, and a bunch of regulations. Now, at the same time, don't think that it's okay for her. Oh, Daddy, well, I think I'm just going to go date this one. I'm going to date. No, you're not. Because I can tell you right now, that's not God's will. You are not going to date that boy over there who knows nothing about the ways of God, because the Word of God says, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers.
Amen.
I don't even have to pray about that one. That's not God's will. And if that's what you want to do, then you can go find another place to do it, because it ain't happening right here.
Amen.
But to say that she can't go and to do it, now she might be doing that behind my back. She might say, well, that's fine then. If Daddy don't want to let me date Jimmy, guess what? He got me a car now. I'm going to do what I want to do. And he ain't looking. That's on you, girl. That's between you and your Jesus. And guess what? I told you. I took my stand. I tried to instruct you in the right ways. At some point in time, I got to trust you. I got to trust God. And I got to allow grace to be the shepherd of your heart.
Amen.
But to think that you're going to let me be complicit with you in your sin, that you transgressing God and going to go connect yourself to some boy that has no interest in doing the right thing for you other than, you know what? Then guess what? You ain't getting me involved in that.
Amen.
I'm not stupid. I know what they got in their heart and what they want to do.
Amen.
And it ain't just the boys nowadays, it's the girls.
Amen.
And the reality of it is that all I can do is try to instruct them, right?
Amen.
And so what I'm trying to get at is that God desires for us to instruct our children in the right ways and in order for us to be able to allow them to learn what it means. This I want to try to get this across. I'm having a hard time articulating it. We have to teach our children how to have a relationship with God.
Right.
Not just some form of religion where they went to church and they didn't see a change take place in their parents and the change never took place in them. They have to understand you must be born again. You must be saved. You must receive Jesus for yourself. And the people of God do things differently than the people of the world. And all I can do is tell you that, show you that, but I cannot make you believe that.
Amen.
And the reality of it is this, that along the pathway and along the journey, as they make their own decisions, they are going to make mistakes, but God doesn't waste anything. I'm way ahead of myself in this message. The Word of God in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 5 says, you have forgotten the exhortation. And the word exhortation is an interesting word because it literally is paraklesis in the Greek, which is a similar word that John uses for the comforter of the Holy Spirit, parakletos. And it literally means to be called near. So whenever the word paraklesis is being used, it's almost like a father would exhort his son, and this is the way the instruction would take place. It's almost like, come sit down, son. Honey, sweetheart, come sit down right here. Let's talk. And so the idea is that it's not whenever Matt was in one of the angry tirades and punched the cabbage. The idea is that I love you, and I want to instruct you and try the best that I can to explain this to you. And I know that if I do it in a fit of anger, you're not going to listen to anything that I have to say. I want to reason with you on this. I want to share the wisdom of God with you on this. Have you forgotten the calling near, which speaks unto you as unto children? My son, despise not the chastening of the Lord. To despise literally means to set it naught, to think that it's light, it's a light thing. It doesn't mean really much. You know, the things that my daddy says don't mean much. That's a dangerous place for a young person to be, or for us when it comes to the chastening of the Lord. Now, sometimes with the word chastening, we automatically think of punishment, but the reality of it is that it has to do with all of the choices that are made. The word literally means choices that are made. It's almost like as you're walking the journey, choices are made.
Yes.
Wrong choices are made.
Yes.
Even though you were a Christian and you were instructed in the ways of God, you went out on your own. You made wrong choices.
Yes. Yes.
Wrong choices had repercussions.
Yes.
The
yes.
repercussions most times caused what?
Pain.
Pain.
Pain hurts. But you know what? There's not a better learning tool
Amen.
Than pain.
That's right.
Because when you get some pain applied to your life, you remember.
Amen. Yeah.
And so that chastening, God uses that as instruction
yes.
in the midst of your life.
Amen.
And then sometimes you come back upon that decision again, and now the opportunity for a right choice is made.
Amen.
I ain't going there again, because last time I did that, it caused a lot of pain.
Amen.
And I don't want pain
That's correct.
In the midst of my life. Holy Spirit, I put my faith in what Jesus did. Give me grace to strengthen me and to produce the fruit of the Holy Spirit in my life instead of the lust of the flesh in my life in this circumstance. Despise not the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when you are rebuked of him. I wish I had a rope. Because the word faint literally means to unloose yourself or to untie. You know, sometimes whenever you find yourself in grievous circumstances, you find yourself in the midst of a mess, sometimes you can get bombarded so much when you're in the midst of the mess that you want to loose yourself, right?
Yeah.
It ain't working no more, dude. The pain is too much. I'm just going to go ahead and loosen up this knot and just let it go.
Yeah.
It's a slow thing that takes place. Nobody even around you at first knows that it's happening. Mm. You just lose yourself.
Yeah.
It's a sad thing.
Yeah.
Begin to pull away from the things of God. Don't lose yourself.
Amen.
Don't untie yourself when you find yourself under the instruction of the Lord, because God has a plan and a desire. Amen. So you as parents, don't unloose yourself. Children, if you're listening today, even though sometimes it seems as though now there's also a balance with that. See, God knows, and the scripture's going to get into that in a second. God knows how to properly discipline his children. He knows just how much to give and when to back off. Unfortunately, parents don't. That's why Paul had to write the Ephesians.
Right.
You know, I can't even think of the passage. What is it? Provoke. Don't provoke your children to anger.
Right.
The word there literally means to exasperate.
Right.
It's like you're not held them under your hand so hard for so long and you never like let up that they can't even breathe no more. It's almost like a pound of the weight on their chest and it's collapsing and they can't even breathe. They've been exasperated. The word of God says don't exasperate your children. Don't hold them so far down with a heavy hand that they can't even breathe or see straight. Amen. And so there's a balance between proper discipline and at the same time overdoing it. So the scripture goes on to say that in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 7, it says that if you endure chastening, God deals with you as sons, for what son is he whom the Father chastens not? And so the idea of enduring means to remain under. I've explained this word a lot, you know, through the history of the Bible study, because I think that this is a word that I heard Brother Larson teach on one time, and it had a profound effect on my life. And I just love this word. It's a compound word. This word is a preposition in the Greek, and it means under, and this word means remain. So the word is it's translated as endure. Sometimes it's translated as persevere, but the word literally means remain under. See, many times, this is the opposite of unloosing or untying. When we find ourselves in the midst of the trial, what we oftentimes want to do is we want to run.
Yes.
Whatever the situation may be, I don't really know how else to explain some of the better analogies, but it's not just these analogies, can be in the workplace. God's chastening me. There's things in my life that he's wanting to deal with, but I'm being like a horse and mule, being stiff-necked. He's trying to put the bridle in my mouth. I don't really want to listen. And now it gets so hot that what I want to do is I want to run and go find him. See, it's everybody else's fault.
Right.
So I got to go find me another job. Sometimes in the church setting. This trial and tribulation is happening. I don't like the way that this person's treating me. Trust me, buddy. When you hang around people long enough, you're going to find somebody that you don't like the way they treat you. You probably won't like the way the preacher does either. But the reality of it is that God's changing me. He's changing you. And every single time that we don't like the way that he feels and we get up and we run, it takes that much longer for God to deal with those. Because there's things in your heart too.
Yeah.
It's not just all the preacher that's wrong.
Yeah.
It's not just all your husband or your wife that's wrong. There's things in you too that God wants to deal with.
Yeah.
Hello, newsflash. You got stuff in your heart, man.
Yeah.
Jeremiah 17, 9 and 10 said that the heart of man is deceitfully wicked. Who can know it? God knows how to apply the right amount of pressure to that right circumstance in that situation to allow that dross to come lifted up to the top where it can be seen. It's like, ooh, that's ugly right there.
Amen. Yes.
But if you don't know the ways of God, you don't know the things of God, you don't even think it's
ugly.
You think it's normal. No, it ain't normal. God wants to deal with it. Amen. And so he says, to endure, remain under the chastening of the Lord. God deals with you as with sons, for what son is he whom the Father chastens not? God desires to chasten his children because he desires to produce godliness in the midst of their lives. Amen? Yes. Does that make sense?
Amen.
In verses 9 through 10, it says this. I love this passage of scripture. This is the first time I really saw it exactly like this because I kind of looked into some words that I had never looked at before. It says, furthermore, we have fathers of our flesh which corrected us. In other words, our physical fathers. Remember whenever your daddy used to correct you, sometimes he did it wrong. You know, that was really supposed to be talking about godly fathers. And so we hope that as godly fathers, we learn some right ways, right? So try not to think back to the time, you know, my daddy, I can't remember one time my dad told me. And you know, I'm glad he shared some of these stories with me because it at least explains to me a little bit why he was the way he was. He told me a story one time where he said, boy, my old man was rough, son. I said, oh, yeah? He said, yeah. He said, they had six boys, I think. Was it six? I don't know. They had six boys, I think, and one daughter. One daughter, and she ended up being a nun. But one day, my pawpaw had his hand up in the air like this, and Beth, the only daughter, was the only one in the hallway with him. And my daddy's older brother, Thomas, thought that he was about to hit her. He ain't never really hit the girl, as far as I know, but he always used to hit on them. And so Thomas tried to go intervene. And he said, I turned the corner. And he said, all I saw was my daddy kicking that boy up one side of the wall, down the other, almost like he was a soccer ball. You know, and so what I guess the only reason I brought that up was I don't know what your upbringing was. I don't know how your daddy treated you. And I don't want you to revert back and remember that. As a matter of fact, it's probably maybe the Lord wanted to bring that up for this circumstance. I don't know how your daddy treated you. And I don't know how harsh he was towards you. But sometimes whenever that happens, it skews our understanding of what the true love of a father really is.
Amen.
Because you've got to understand something. The Father in heaven is nothing like that.
That's right.
The Father in heaven has not been tainted by sin. He's only love.
Amen.
And he's love in the giving fashion.
Right.
And so while we have to let go and through the grace of God forgive the way that our Father on earth may have treated us, the reality of it is this, is that the Father in heaven, he has what's best for you.
Amen.
I just want to tell you that. Amen.
Amen.
It says right here, furthermore, we have had fathers in our flesh or in our physical lives which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. I mean, we were supposed to, at least the people of God back then would have revered their fathers, because the proverb said that, you know, that if you want to live a long life, then you need to obey your parents. And we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? For they verily, for a few days, chastened us after their own pleasure. I never really did understand that, because that King James word. So what are you doing? I mean, you're getting excitement out of whooping your kids. I mean, what's the deal there? But when you look into it, it really means their own opinions, their own understanding of things. And the sad thing, be told, is once again, men, fathers, have their own opinions on the way things should be done, and sometimes they're right, and sometimes they're wrong. And even in Christian fathers, sometimes our opinions are right, but sometimes our opinions are wrong.
Amen.
And we have to be big enough to allow God to reveal to us when we're wrong. And I don't know how it works for you, because I know you can say sorry so many times that it becomes meaningless. I get that. I've had some people kind of tell me that, dude, you're not really sorry. You just need to quit saying it. But no, really, I am sorry. But nevertheless, maybe I just say it more than you. But I do know that I've told my kids I was sorry many times. I've told my kids before whenever I messed up. I told my kids I didn't handle you right in that situation, and I would hope that you would forgive me. That's just a little bit of humility. I mean, you do what you want with that, but I want them to be able to see that I mess up sometimes. I want them to be able to see that I can humble myself. I want them to be able to humble themselves. Amen. And I want them to know that they're going to mess up too. Amen. All right. For they verily for a few days chastened us after their own pleasure, but he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. Amen. The whole purpose of the chastisement of God in the life of the child of God is that ultimately through the process we learn the right, the wrong, and guess what? We hold on to him and we continue to go down the path, the narrow path, where he's changing us and we're being conformed into the image of Jesus and we're looking more like him and less like the world. Does that make sense? Hallelujah, that we become partakers of his holiness. God wants to change us. Amen. Or do you know that God's still in the life changing business and the heart changing business? Are you okay? Are you open for some heart change?
Amen.
And because if you're going to serve God, you need to be open to some heart change.
Amen.
All right. Well, really, I kind of really towards the end of my message right at this point, but with all this talk about training and instruction and chastening and scourging and enduring, and like I talked to you about a little bit earlier, I talked about the fact that sometimes even while they're still in the house, you got to let go a little bit. If you turn with me to the book of Luke, I believe it is, and I know that I mentioned this text the other day. It's the prodigal son. And I love the story of the prodigal son. I don't want to try to preach the whole thing, but we can just kind of read through, and I just want to make a couple of quick points, and then we'll close with that. Luke 15, verse 11. And he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. So really, that was one of the main points I wanted to make, is that with all this talk about instruction and encouraging and enduring and scourging, there comes back that time whenever we see within the heart of our children that they have their own free will. And this young man came to his father and said, it's time. It's time for me to go. I want you to give me the portion that belongs to me. And the Bible says that what the father did was he made a choice. He went ahead and he just divided the inheritance up at that point in time. And he gave it to the young man. See, one of the things that I began to realize is that I suppose in reality the father didn't have to do that at that point in time if he didn't want to. It still belonged to him. I mean, I don't know what all the laws are surrounding all of that, but the reality of it is that if this young man wanted to get his inheritance before an early time, I suppose the father didn't have to do that. But nevertheless, the father in this situation, because see, that's the heart of the father in heaven. He created us with a free will, and he will allow us to go in our own. It's not what he wants. He knows that it's not what's best. But he will allow us to go in our own direction if that is what we choose to do. And in this situation, this is exactly what we're seeing. We're seeing the heart of the child exerting their free will and the father allowing it to take place. What it says is this, is that verse 12, and the younger of them said to his father, give me my portion of goods that falleth to me, and he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. So he didn't listen. I mean, if this is the people of God, the children of God, they understood. They had access to the Proverbs. They had access to other wisdom literature. And what he chose to do was not to listen to the wisdom of God, but instead to live his life riotously. And he plundered the things that he had received from his father. And it says in verse 14, and when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. The reality of it is that so oftentimes we make our own choices to go in our own direction. And what ends up happening is this, is that when we go in our own direction and we transgress the ways of God, there becomes a famine in our spiritual life. Amen. And not only that, we come to the place of want. The word want there means lack. It means that there's an empty spot. And whatever you were trying to fill yourself up with, it left you empty, it left you in lack, it left you still wanting something. It goes on to say in verse 15, and he went and he joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed the swine. So he had moved far, far away from the presence of God, and then he connected himself to a Gentile, a person who did not know the ways of God, so much so that it was a person who was a purveyor, obviously, of swine meat, which was considered unclean by the Jewish people. So really what the text is saying, what Jesus is trying to tell us is this, he's connecting himself to uncleanness. And in the midst of all of that, it says this, that and he would fain have filled his belly with the husks. I know that there used to be a word that people, drug addicts, used to say back in the 80s, something about fiending or something like that. That's obviously where that word came from, because that's what the word literally means in the Greek. It's epithumia. It's another word that's translated in the English language as lust. Right. He lusted after the husks of the pigs. He wanted to eat what the pigs eat.
Yes.
Rather than, how far had he fallen? His free will had taken him down a pathway and a journey that had left him empty in the midst of famine and left him so much in a situation that he was lusting after the pig food.
Amen.
He says, and he went and he joined himself, he says in 16, and he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, see, there's always hope.
Yes.
There's always hope, Father, because you might find yourself in the midst of a situation one day where you feel like you poured your life into your children, and what they did was, instead of heeding the counsel of God, they ran off and they did their own thing, they went their own way, and the reality of it is, though, is this, is that as you pray, as you trust God in the midst of it all, we hope that there comes the place in their life when they come to themselves, when the Holy Spirit gives them an epiphany, whenever the light bulb comes on, amen. And they awaken out of their sinful slumber, and they wake up. And it wasn't, yes, you did instruction, yes, you told them, yes, you were there for them, but you can't turn the light bulb on. Only God can turn the light bulb on, amen. And when He does, hallelujah, now the light is on. That's what we need, Lord. We need you to turn our light bulb on so that we can see the truth of the gospel.
Man,
it says, when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and spare, and I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. Can I come to a place of repentance and humility, and am no more worthy to be called your son? Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. You know, I don't know, has your kids ever done stuff to you that got you so mad that you almost felt like, I ain't never gonna forgive that kid? That little, you know, little rat did me dirty, man. People do you dirty, you know what I'm saying? You're like, I ain't forget that kid, like that little brat. That's the devil, man. I'm telling you right now, boy, you think the devil don't mess with Christian daddies? Look, he tried to put a root of bitterness on the inside of your heart, make you hate your own children.
Yes.
Lady, don't treat me like that. I'll write you off. Take a Sharpie and cut your name out.
Yes.
Not that I got anything to give you anyway, but I'm going to cut your name out, man. Not this one. That's not the heart of the Father in heaven.
No. Amen.
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 He's over here waiting. Oh, I've been praying for you, boy. I've been praying that you'd find yourself in the midst of that pig slop, and that you'd come to yourself, and that you'd come to the realization that God is love. Hallelujah. And even if you don't, when you're ready to eat pig slop, and instead you find yourself cruising down the road. I was Googling electric cars last night in a Tesla. Oh yeah, man, that thing's running $125,000, way out of my league. Even if one day you find yourself with a degree and you a surgeon and you driving a Tesla to work or whatever it is that you drive, and you find yourself, you just living right. Oh, like old boy, I ain't gonna tell you his name. Living the dream, baby. Oh, look, daddy's calling. Click, yeah, what's up, man? Oh, what you doing, son? Living the dream, dad, living the dream. Yeah, but then one day you come to the realization you might not be ready to eat it. A hog slop, but when you realize your Tesla, your Land Rover, whatever it is that you drive, your big house, your nice clothes, your good job, and all of the things that you poured your life into left you just as empty as that old boy that was ready to eat pig slop, then guess what? You can also come to yourself, amen, and get a light bulb turned on by the Holy Ghost when you get a revelation. Oh, I got to come back to God. All those things my daddy told me were right. He might not have said it right all the time. I wish he wouldn't have punched that cabbage that time, but I'm telling you right now, he was trying to tell me something, and something that he said was right.
Amen.
And whenever he got over there to the Lord, to his father, he said unto him, Father, I have sinned against you in heaven, and in thy sight, am no more worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe, put it on him, and put a ring on his hand, and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf, and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. You know, he said, for my son was dead and is alive again, and he was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. You know, he had another son, and I'm just going to close with this. He had another son who never left, and in his eyes, he had done everything right. And the reality of it is this, is that he hadn't done everything right because his heart was wrong. His heart wasn't full of love. In reality, his heart was full of self-righteousness. You know, I have two different kids. I just want to remind you of that. Because sometimes you feel like you got this one kid that's just doing everything right, and you got this other kid that didn't seem to do anything right. But lo and behold, next thing you know, the one that didn't seem to do anything right is the one that really loves the Lord and is living for God. And the one that seemed to do everything right don't have to first think about the things of God. And so what I'm trying to get at is this. Amen. Never give up hope. Do your work of a father. Learn the ways of God. Study the ways of God. Let the counsel of God come on the inside of you so that you can impart that wisdom unto your children.